Hello, and welcome to another episode of White House History Live. My name is Colleen Shogan, and I serve as a Senior Vice President at the White House Historical Association and the Director of the David Rubenstein Center for White House History. The White House Historical Association is a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization with a mission to educate Americans about the rich and diverse history of the Executive Mansion and the people who lived and worked there. Tonight's episode is a special one. I'm joined by my colleague, Marcia Anderson, who will talk about the newly released version of the White House History Guidebook. Marcia Anderson is the association's chief publishing officer and the editor of White House History Quarterly. She joined the association in 1998 as the association's first in-house publishing professional. In addition to seeing the White House a historic guide through its transition from 20th century hot type to 21st century digital age, she has produced more than 100 books and quarterly magazines for the association. A reminder for this evening, we will be taking questions from our online viewing audience at the end of our program. And a special bonus for everyone this evening, we will be giving away one of our newly published guidebooks to a viewer who asks a question in the chat. So please pose a question for Marcia for a chance to win a copy of the official White House guidebook. And please join me in welcoming Marcia to White House History Live.
Thank you, Colleen.
Great. Marcia, this summer marks the 60th anniversary of the White House guidebook. Can you tell us a little bit about how the guidebook came to be?
Well, sure. The story begins in 1941 when 11-year-old Jacqueline Bouvier, the future First Lady, visited the White House as a tourist with her mother. She was already well-traveled and had visited many museums, and so logically, she expected to find a guidebook available that would enrich her tour of the White House. But the White House was not yet thought of as a museum in 1941, and there was no curator and no museum-style guide. Mrs. Kennedy later said, "All I could remember was shuffling through." And we know that on this visit to Washington with her mother at Easter time in 1941, she visited the Smithsonian and the National Gallery. And these are catalogs from that time that she would have likely seen.
So Jackie Kennedy becomes First Lady in 1961. Had things changed by the time she becomes First Lady with the White House and the guidebook?
No, not really. 20 years later, when she returned as First Lady, visitors still still simply filed in through the East Gate at posted hours, and there was no guidebook to be had. And I love these pictures because posted hours are really posted hours. They're posted on the visitor's entrance at the east side of the White House. And you can see the crowds just lined up and filed right in. But Mrs. Kennedy had not forgotten her disappointing childhood experience, and so she quickly set things in motion to make the White House a museum, as well as the president's home and office. And within a year, a fine arts committee was formed, a curator was hired, a law was passed making the White House collection inalienable or permanent, and the White House Historical Association, a nonprofit educational partner, was chartered. And the association undertook as its first project the publication of a guidebook for the historic White House.
And so why did you publish a new edition this year?
Well, we decided to publish the 26th edition, which we are calling our 60th anniversary edition, in the summer of 2022 to celebrate 60 years in print, and also to mark the beginning of the post-COVID return to a full schedule of public tours at the White House, and to do important updates to the room photography and the descriptions. These are a couple of photos from our launch date last week of the guidebook on sale in our White House History Shop on 8th Street and in use in Lafayette Park.
So let's go back to 1962 with the first guidebook. Where was it sold? How was it sold? And how did the public receive it? Did anybody buy it?
Yes, the guidebook was an immediate success. It went on sale in the East Wing near the tour entrance on July 4th, 1962, And on the right, you can see a picture of that first day of sale. Mrs. Kennedy had decided that the price would be exactly $1 because most people would be carrying $1. And she was right. Most visitors bought at least one copy at the beginning of their visit. Nash Castro, the association's first administrator, worked the sales desk himself that day and can be seen in the photo on the right selling books. In later years, he often talked about launch day and recalled people coming in with grocery carts and buying 50 or 75 or 100 copies of the book. He also said not to ask him why they were doing that because he didn't have time himself to ask why they were buying so many copies that day. So by December 1962, in less than 6 months, the print runs already totaled 600,000 copies and they were in their third printing. Today, the guide sold more than 5 million copies.
Wow. Was Mrs. Kennedy, was she at all involved in the publication and the editing and the writing of the guidebook?
Yes, very much so. And we know this in part from the recollections of those people that she worked with. The historic guide was presented to President Mrs. Kennedy by David Finley, the association's first chairman of the board, in a small ceremony pictured here in the Roosevelt Room on June 28, 1962, a few days before the official release to the public. And we have, and I'm showing a picture of it, we have a really wonderful carbon copy of Mr. Finley's remarks in our files that provides a record of what he said. And he notes that there would be no surprises for Mrs. Kennedy in the book, and that was because she had worked on it herself. In his speech, he noted that her knowledge of history, good judgment, and impeccable taste are evident on every page. And also the association's administrator, Nash Castro, later remembered in an oral history that was done with him, that he'd had a nearly 5-hour meeting with Mrs. Kennedy to review the draft. And he said that she went over every single page, making suggestions along the way.
Now, you talked about people lining up to buy the guidebook. How did people know it was for sale without the internet? How did the word spread?
Well, that's a really interesting question, Colleen. And I love it that Nash Castro kept files, meticulous files, and that we can trace the details in those files today. And one of these files contains the very first press release and some notes on the promotional plans. What I'm calling a press release is actually the document on the left, but it's very simple. The association did no advertising and employed no publicist. The short and simple announcement seen here was sent to the press on June 25th, 1962. So that's barely 10 days or so before the launch. But it was widely published in newspapers and magazines all across the country. It ran in Good Housekeeping, Time, Antiques, Popular Photography, The Washington Post, The Baltimore Sun, Congressional Newsletters, and just about every small town paper in the country. And Nash Castro kept tear sheets of all those articles, which were very fun to go through. So it was really big news. And the promotional plan seen here on the right is also very simple, and it has some handwritten notes from Mr. Castro on it. The plan that they put together began with a formal presentation to President Mrs. Kennedy, which we know was accomplished on June 28th. And the other notes are interesting too. Note 5 expressed a concern that sharing photos with AP and UPI might smack of too much promotion. And there's a little handwritten note beside that note number 5 that they're going to discuss that some more. The association was very reticent at that time to be too aggressive in seeking publicity. And then note 8 emphasizes that the focus of the promotion should be the news value of the guide, and that the news value of the guide was that it was a first in White House history.
Now, people could come to the White House and obviously buy the guide, but what about people, like you said, this ran in small town newspapers all across the United States. What if you couldn't get to Washington, D.C. to buy the guide? Could you order it by mail?
Yes, and this is a fun story to recount. And I really felt for Mr. Castro, having known him myself and having read his files about what it must have been like for him. But as a result of the widely published story, the association was unexpectedly inundated with letters containing $1 bills. The orders were delivered by the post office in large mail bags. Six or seven were delivered at a time, Mr. Castro remembered. And at that time, the association's entire staff consisted of Mr. Castro and a secretary. And because the mail contained thousands of dollars and couldn't be answered right away, Mr. Castro rented a vault at Riggs Bank, which you can see here on the lower right, which is just across the street from the White House. And he worked out a system where he would take the new bags of mail over for safekeeping in the vault and take the old bags out to process. He developed form letter responses to answer much of the mail. And he also remembered that he would take some home and sit in his backyard under a tree with a dictating machine and dictate responses. He answered every letter. Carbon copies of the letters remain in the publishing department's files today. And I've read them, and the scope of the public's interest is very moving, as is Mr. Castro's determination to answer every letter.
So people actually mailed $1 in the envelope, and it was only cost them a dollar to get the guidebook.
Yes, that's right. At first, if you mailed the association a dollar, you would receive a guide as if you were buying it in person in the shop. But after about 6 months, though, the mail order price was raised to $1.25. And I think it was a little bit of an agonizing decision, and they fretted over how they would announce that to the public. But they raised the price to $1.25 to cover the postage and the packaging. And we have in the files on this legal pad a draft announcement from David Finley about the decision, which was made in December 1962. Mm-hmm. But reading through the files, it's clear that the price change only served to increase the correspondence burden for the long-suffering Mr. Castro, as he began to receive orders that contained either too much or too little money. And I think it's interesting that if someone sent too much, he would send them a formal typewritten letter explaining what had happened. And then to reimburse them, he would include the right amount of U.S. postage stamps as reimbursement. And if they sent too little, he would write a letter and ask for more money. And then one of my favorite letters was related to Amy Vanderbilt's etiquette column. She published a notice of the guidebook in her etiquette column, but she failed to include the rate hike for the postage and handling, and listed the price as a dollar instead of $1.25. And this prompted a polite letter from Nash Castro, thanking her for noting the guide, but asking her to be sure to get the price right next time.
So, I mean, this just demonstrates whether it's at the White House or whether sending in $1 bills for a copy of the guidebook, there was tremendous enthusiasm for this book when it was released in 1962. Why do you think that was the case?
I love that question, Colleen, and I think it's interesting because really the guidebook is just a book. It's just a book about a house, like many guides to other historic houses are. But there was an emotional connection between the association's first book and the public that embraced it that went far beyond what other museum guides represented. So the public was certainly familiar with the exterior of the house, but the interior of the house would likely have been a mystery to those who had never been inside. And Mrs. Kennedy had famously said that the White House belongs to the American people. And with the guide, the nation was getting its first glimpse of the house that belonged to them. So they had no hesitation spending a dollar or even $1.25 to learn about the house that belonged to the American people. And again, the guide was really the first and for its time only comprehensive published work on the White House. And to us today, it was the beginning of a whole field of study of White House history.
So let's talk about the production of the book. How has that changed during your time, even at the association?
Well, the changes have been dramatic. The first guidebook was set in hot metal type. And when I started in my position in 1998, the guide was still updated by setting lines of new type on a linotype machine, similar to the one seen here on the left. When the type was set, it was set in lines and strips. And those strips were stripped into the existing files, the existing film for the book. And it was a slow and complicated process and really limited the number of changes that were made with each new edition. Over the next few years, after I started working here, we converted to electronic files, which was, you know, really the norm for that period of time. And that enabled us to much more easily update the text. So today we manage design and production from our desktop computers. And this is a picture of our senior editorial and production manager, Kristen Mason, at work on the most recent edition of the guidebook on her computer in our offices.
So what about the proofing process? How does that work?
So the proofing process has changed significantly too. Until about 15 years ago or so, I think, the printer provided blue lines for us to review prior to printing. So they were made in one color. They were all blue. So we generally physically went to the printing plant while a job was printing to check the color. That's known as a press check. You probably heard that term. But now we have very accurate color proofs, and we can make color approvals from our desks. Also, at the end of the George W. Bush administration, we switched to digital photography, which further streamlined our production process.
So how did you do the photography before it was digitized, before you had the ability to take hundreds of photographs of the same room? How was it done?
Well, our photographers used film, and they would usually shoot with 3x5 film and deliver transparencies. The curators from the White House and I would consult with the photographers during the shot. And once we had the angle determined, they would often do quick Polaroid test shots in black and white. And you can see a couple of examples of those here. Mm-hmm. That would allow us to confirm the angle and also to make fine adjustments around the room to make sure candles were straight, for example, and that electrical cords were hidden. But even with the test Polaroids, we really didn't know what the final photos looked like until the transparencies, you know, came in and were scanned. And for that reason, we didn't experiment very much with new angles in those years, but stuck to really tried and successful views. And if you look at the first editions, the first, you know, at least 15 editions of the guidebook, you'll see a lot of the same angles used in one edition after another.
And tell us a little bit about the photography today with digital capabilities.
Well, today, the moment the photographer takes a shot, and you can see a couple of pictures in the diplomatic reception room from the shooting of the current guide. So the moment the photographer takes a shot with his camera, it appears on his laptop, and it makes fine-tuning the details so much easier. You know, we'll all gather around and look at the laptop, and we'll know that will be the picture that will be delivered to us. And this allows us to take more photos and to experiment with new angles and to try some new things.
So when you're going to work on a new edition of the guidebook, who is involved traditionally in working on that update? And when you go to the White House to shoot this photography, who's involved in the photo shoot?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because there's so many people who are dedicated and talented that make, you know, the guidebook possible, that we've worked with over the years. And those have included curators, scholars, editors, writers, artists, designers, and pre-press operators. And then there's the group of talented photographers as well, who have contributed to the book over 60 years. And now their body of work really serves as a primary record of the decor and furnishing of the White House since 1962. And most importantly, the White House staff members who have accommodated our photographer over the years, help prepare the room for the shot. So in addition to the curators, these people include members of the First Lady's staff in the usher's office, the florist, the operations crew, the groundskeepers, and the housekeepers. And then the decision is about what to shoot. are made based on what, you know, has changed since the last edition. So it might be, you know, fairly minor change in placement of artworks or furnishings, or it might be something more significant, such as a major refurbishment of the room. The Oval Office spread that you see here is an example of a photograph that we routinely retake, you know, at the beginning of every administration once the new president has begun to set up the room, you know, his own way. There's also a picture in this spread that I really like, which is the ceiling of the Oval Office, which we'd never had the chance to photograph before because we usually would run out of time. And I think this is a special picture. We've always talked about it in the guidebook, but this was the first time we were able to include it.
So how were you influenced or mentored by people who worked on the guidebook before you?
Well, I was very fortunate to work with a number of the association's founders and early leaders who worked with Mrs. Kennedy on the production of the first guide. And there are three of them pictured here who are really special, I think. Robert Breeden on the left was with the National Geographic, and he managed the production of the first edition of the guidebook. And when I began my job, he was the association's chairman of the board. And Nash Castro, who I've mentioned several times tonight, was the association's first administrator. And then Hugh Seide, who was a journalist with Life magazine and later with Time, worked with Mrs. Kennedy on the famous article in Life magazine in which she announced her plans for the White House. And all of these men were, you know, truly brilliant and dedicated and fabulous storytellers, and worked to preserve the history of the association's founding and the first guide by sharing their memories. And what I learned from them continues to inform my work with the association. They shared a reverence for Mrs. Kennedy's accomplishment and humility for the responsibility that they shouldered. And of course, technically, my work was very different from theirs, but philosophically, the goals for the project have never changed.
When you say that your work was technically different, can you tell us a little bit more about that? Give us some examples.
I think that the strongest example would be in how we communicate. You know, looking back at the world in 1961 and 1962, things were so different. I rely so heavily on computers and emails, and it's incredible to think that they didn't even have cell phones in those years. Many of their stories involved how they resolved issues and problems by rushing over to one another's homes, even late at night. And Mr. Breeden often talked about ringing the doorbell at Lorraine Pierce's house to show her a proof or a draft or something after midnight. And then he would chuckle and say that made her angry. Lorraine Pierce, of course, was the first White House curator who drafted the guidebook text for Mrs. Kennedy's review. And she's seen here, of course, on a landline at work with Mrs. Kennedy. Mr. Castro and Mr. Breeden also wrote each other formal typewritten memos and notes. And those notes discussed the printing details and just about everything relating to producing a book. And then they filed the carbons, which I've been fortunate enough to read through. But I imagine it would take a few days to get a letter back where, you know, as I can write an email and maybe get an answer in the next few moments. So it's just amazing to me how quickly they produced the first guide. And other story that I can never get off my mind is in those first years that I knew Mr. Breeden, he never emailed me. He always called me at work on the landline. And he tended to do this on Friday evenings after 5 o'clock. So I was very careful to stay at my desk just in case he was going to call to check in.
So has every First Lady been involved with the guidebook? We know Mrs. Kennedy was, but what about subsequent First Ladies?
Definitely, and in different ways. Every First Lady since Mrs. Kennedy, most recently Dr. Biden, has been involved to some extent with the guide, and all have written the opening letters that welcome the reader to the White House. Here we can see a copy of Mrs. Kennedy's original letter in the first edition, and Dr. Biden's most recent letter, which appears in the 26th edition. Many first ladies have also helped the association celebrate milestones in the guide's history.
Well, tell us about some of those milestones. And I know you have some good photographs of them.
Yeah, we do. We have got some great photos of past celebrations beginning on the left in 1964 when the 1 millionth guide was sold. This is a photo of First Lady Lady Bird Johnson in 1964 visiting the East Wing sales desk to sign and present the 1 millionth copy to the buyer, who was a woman from Omaha, Nebraska. And then on the left, on the right in 1971, First Lady Pat Nixon is seen during an event to celebrate the release of the 10th edition, and she also autographed copies for many visitors. The next picture features Mrs. Reagan, who held a party to celebrate the release of the 15th edition and 20 years in print. If we can go to the next picture. There we go. Yeah, that's perfect. And I love this photograph. By then, the sales had exceeded 1 million copies, and Mrs. Reagan invited all the current and former White House curators to the party. They're seen here. So if you look from left to right, Clem Conger and Betty Monkman, who are currently working in the White House, James Ketchum, and Bill Elder, who worked during the Kennedy administration, and then of course, Lorraine Pierce, who had worked so hard on the text to the first guide. And then the picture on the right is a time capsule that was put in place during the George H.W. Bush presidency, actually to mark the 200th anniversary of the laying of the White House cornerstone and the guide's 30 years in print. President and Mrs. Bush were present at a ceremony, and they added to the time capsule an official White House Christmas ornament, as well as a copy of the guidebook. And then the next celebration that we have some pictures of was in 2011. It's the release of the 50th anniversary edition. Mrs. Obama welcomed the association's board and staff, along with presidential descendants, to the White House to celebrate the occasion. Caroline Kennedy spoke to the guests on the legacy of her mother's work. And we also had a book signing at the White House Visitor Center. And this photo includes several people who played important roles in producing that 50th edition. On the left is principal photographer Bruce White, and next to Bruce is Bill Allman, who was the curator of the White House at the time and worked and wrote a lot of the text of the 50th anniversary edition. And then next to Bill is Betty Monkman, who had retired from the White House, but remained involved with the guidebook and served as managing editor of our 50th anniversary edition.
So has the approach to the content and structure of the guide changed over time?
Yes, it has evolved as public access to the White House has changed over the years, and also as the association's title list has grown to include comprehensive books on architecture, fine and decorative arts, and landscape. And many of those books are seen here. The guide doesn't try to cover every topic thoroughly, but works to serve as an ultimate basic room by room reference that will then lead readers to other books to learn more about the subjects that interest them. And then let's see, the next slide illustrates another change in our approach to the guide, which came in 2011 with the 50th anniversary edition. During the late 1990s, more than a million people still visited the White House annually on tours. And the challenge for me at that time was not how to sell the guide, but how to keep it in print. Reprint orders were placed every few months for 30,000 or more copies. And just as it had for 40 years, the guide quickly sold itself to visitors who toured the White House. But public tours were suddenly halted following the terrorist attacks of September 11th, 2001. The association's booksellers area in the East Wing was closed to the public, and tours were suspended, and the guide sales immediately dropped 90%. And I still have the note. It was left on my desk by our accountant at that time, who used a pencil. And he just wrote a very simple note with a white piece of paper and a pencil that said 90% and an arrow down, and left that on my desk, which was very upsetting after so many years of having just the opposite problem, keeping it in print. But this closure stretched on for months and then for years. And as it turned out, the limited access to the White House actually increased the public's need for an illustrated guide, not to follow on an in-person tour, but as a resource that could inform in place of a tour. So with this in mind, the 50th anniversary edition was redesigned for the reader who might, or more likely at that time, might not have had the opportunity to go inside the White House. And this is an example from the 50th anniversary edition that that I like, and it's something that we added to that edition. And it starts on the north side and basically tells the reader to begin your tour here. And we purposefully shot it with, you know, people on the sidewalk and the Secret Service agent at work, so that people would know they were standing in the right place to begin their tour. And there's a whole section that follows follows this, which is an architectural tour that can be taken from outside the fence. And that's something we continue to publish today.
So tell us what's new in the 60th anniversary edition. Some of our viewers may have bought previous editions of the guidebook, but why would be a reason to look at the latest edition?
Sure. So as I said, we've built on some concepts that we introduced in the 50th anniversary edition to make it useful to those who can visit and those who can't. But we've broken a few boundaries, expanding the dimensions of special photographs, as you can see in this example of the Blue Room, to give a much wider view. You know, before we just stayed constrained to the dimensions of the two-page spread, but with a number of our pictures, we've gone wider to really make a three-page spread and show a room from wall to wall. And then we've also gone behind the scenes to show some places that we've never published in the guidebook before. This includes the first photographs we've ever published of the collection storage area, and a behind the scenes look at some important workspaces of the White House staff, including the flower shop, calligrapher's office, and the kitchen. And the example on the right is the bowling alley, which we published for the first time in this edition.
And what can you tell us about the cover of the 60th anniversary guidebook?
Well, the cover was a special undertaking that used as a way to pay homage really to the first edition in our 60th anniversary edition. In 2019, in anticipation of this long awaited 60th anniversary, we took the opportunity to send our photographer up on one of DC Fire Department's ladder trucks. It's a hydraulically powered ladder truck, to photograph the south side of the White House. And the resulting cover is our sort of 21st century perspective on the 1962 cover, which was taken from a ladder truck on the north side of the house, and for many years appeared on the cover of the guidebook.
In your own words, Marcia, what do you think is the significance of the guidebook to the mission of the White House Historical Association today?
Well, to me, as the association has matured into an award-winning independent publisher with more than 60 titles on White House history, the guidebook really remains at the heart of what we do. It's our flagship publication. It's meant for the general public. And it's a tangible representation of Mrs. Kennedy's vision and the association's mission to enhance understanding, appreciation, and enjoyment of the White House. So it has a lot of sentimental value, but of course it's the most basic of our books, the one that I think all readers should start with if they want to learn the basics about White House history, and from there move on to more detailed subjects that interest them the most. And I think just as Mrs. Kennedy was inspired by the need of the visitors to the White House, we remain inspired by the interest of our readers as we develop and evolve and expand the book.
Great. So we're going to move now to some questions from our live online audience. As a reminder, if you'd like to ask Marcia a question, just type it into the chat function on either YouTube or Facebook. And we will be giving away one copy of the 60th anniversary edition of the guidebook to someone who asks a question online today. So our first question, several people have asked this question, Marcia, Bill and Finley, from Facebook. They ask, are all the rooms of the White House photographed in the guidebook, or are some of the rooms off limits? And if so, what rooms are off limits that you can't photograph?
No, all of the rooms are not included in the guidebook. I think there's, tell me if I'm wrong, Colleen, I think there's 132 rooms in the White House. Mm-hmm. A lot of those are very private, the first family's private living quarters. And we don't show those spaces. We show the rooms that are, that can be seen on the public tour, and rooms that are, you know, official, that have an official or a ceremonial purpose. But we don't show the private living quarters of the first family.
Okay. And how do you do it? Barbara from Facebook asks, do you include in all new recent editions, do you include what was in previous editions of the guidebook? How do you do that?
Yes and no. So we... Our priority is to update rooms that have changed. And so if, say, in this edition, for example, some paintings have moved in the green room and we re-photographed the green room to show the new placement. And if a room is significantly refurbished, we'll re-photograph it as we did with the Oval Office and some other spaces that we hadn't photographed before, like the Roosevelt Room and the West Wing Reception Room. So that's our priority. And then we look back and see, well, are there spaces that we could just refresh or show a different way? And in this edition, a good example, I think, is the East Room, which is one of the rooms that for the first time we photographed in an extra wide shot that goes wall to wall. It's the biggest room in the White House. And so it had always frustrated me that for years we would have a description of the East Room, but we could only show one angle. So the paintings start on one end with President McKinley and then President and Mrs. Washington. And then on the far end, Theodore Roosevelt, and I'd always wished that we could have a photograph that showed that whole range. And so this time with the new photography that we were able to do, the new wider photography, we were able to replace the East Room, although it's very similar to what it would have been in the 25th edition. So there are some decisions that are made just based on, can we show a room a new way? And is it time to refresh a picture?
Mary Jo asks, is there a page limit to the guidebook, or can you keep adding additional pages as you publish new editions?
Well, yes and no, again, because although we could keep adding pages, it would just make the cost prohibitive. So we try to control ourselves when we do that. So we, this guidebook, I think, is about 250 pages, which is similar to the last edition. Mm-hmm. We try not to go too crazy, although it's hard when there's a lot of good things to show. But we want to keep the price reasonable so we don't make it too big.
Betty from Facebook asks, since the White House is considered a museum, are there limits to the changes a new president or first lady can make?
Yes, in the staterooms and in the public rooms, the changes are controlled by the Committee on Committee for Preservation. Sorry, Colleen, can you help me? There's a committee that oversees
Preservation of the White House.
Mm-hmm. For Preservation of the White House, which is a group of professionals who are experts in the fields of decorative and fine arts that provide advice and really oversee any major refurbishments. That's very different from what a first family can do in the private quarters, of course, where they do make changes and we don't see those rooms. So I can't talk about them, but they, like any other, you know, home, you could make the changes that you wanted to be comfortable.
David asks, what about the involvement of the chief usher? He specifically cites J.B. West, but are chief ushers involved in the guidebook at all?
Somewhat. Now, it's different from one administration to the next, but we do work closely with the First Lady's office, and in some cases, the First Lady might rely on the chief usher to help accommodate us with photography or to give us some guidance in photography. It's not the same with every administration. You know, and of course, our primary relationship is with the Office of the Curator.
Mm-hmm. Finley from Facebook asks, are tours currently open at the White House and are earlier editions of the guidebook available for purchase?
Yes, the fuller schedule of public tours resumed at the White House in the middle of July. Mm-hmm. And I think the routine is still the same, that you go through your congressperson's office to get tickets. And the association only sells one edition, the current edition of the guidebook, and that's available on our website. I know you can get older editions on eBay or in resale. A lot of people collect them. So I think it's possible to find the older editions, but they're not sold through the association.
David asked a good question. What about the gardens in the White House? Are they photographed in the guidebook?
You get a glimpse of them. Now, the focus of the guidebook is not on the gardens and grounds. We reserve that for a couple of our other books, including The Living White House, which shows how the gardens and grounds are used. And then we have a bigger book on the president's gardens that's pretty comprehensive on the history of the landscape. The Living White House, our next Living White House, will be out next year in 2023, and that will have some updated pictures in it. In the guidebook, we have a limited number of pictures. We show the Rose Garden and we show the East Garden and several overviews of the grounds, but we don't go into detail on the gardens.
Nan from Facebook asks, has the photography in the guidebook been hampered in any way due to security increases over the years?
I don't think so. I mean, I think I know what he's asking, whether we've been restricted in what we can photograph. And really, we're really only allowed access to the public areas, what the areas that the public sees on tours. And, you know, people can take pictures in the White House now too. So we haven't had any new restrictions in the time that I've been in my job on what we can photograph inside the White House. Mm-hmm.
I know when we went in during the previous administration to do the 360 photography, Secret Service was very careful about some of the things because, of course, in the 360 photography, you're getting the opportunity to get very close in an interactive tour that we have online on whitehousehistory.org. So they were careful about some of the angles and some of the particular areas of some of the rooms that we photographed. And they made sure to take a look at that photography before it was released to the public to make sure that you're keeping, obviously, the first family safe and the people who visit the White House, make sure that they're safe. Yeah. Marcia, can you tell us, you've talked a lot this evening about the guidebook, but as I mentioned earlier in the program, you've worked on over 100 books for the association. Can you tell us about some of the highlights of your publishing record at the association other than the guidebook? And tell us about some upcoming titles that might be coming out either later this year or next year.
Well, sure. The time's gone by so fast, it's kind of a blur. So it's hard to really narrow in on highlights. But I guess as a whole, what we've been developing is really a library of White House history, which is fun to think about and look at as a whole. So we've got books now on the fine arts collection, which shows all of the paintings in the White House, the decorative arts collection, which tells the history of furnishing the White House. We have books on China, the state service collection. And then we have some really specialized topics too, a book on music in the White House, a book on wine in the White House. And there seems to be no end to the subjects that we can cover. And I find that too with White House History Quarterly. We're now on issue 66, which is coming out this summer, which will focus on First Lady's fashion in the late 20th and early 21st century. And that magazine, I was lucky enough to work with William Seal for about 20 years on that. And he fretted at first that maybe we would run out of things to cover, but I don't see that's going to happen. There's a lot of really fun topics coming up. We have an issue coming up on television in the White House that Colleen has written for. That'll be out in the fall. And next year we have an issue on the White House in New York that I'm really looking forward to. In the coming years, we have issues on faith in the White House. We're working on one right now on White House games, board games that have been developed that feature the White House. Pets, of course, fashion, there'll be more fashion, there'll be more geographical kind of things. There doesn't seem to be an end to it. I think the White House is connected to every part of American life. We can find the connections, and we have great writers. They're not all historians or scholars, but they're people who've experienced the White House in some way. So we have some wonderful, like, first-person accounts of living or working or somehow being associated with the White House. And those are some of my favorite articles, the first person. So, yeah, I don't think there's an end to it. And we're increasing the number of children's books that we do as well, and those are special. And then we're continuing our core publications, primarily the guidebook, the Living White House, and next year we'll have some new presidents and first ladies books coming out.
Don't you have a cookbook coming out soon?
Thanks for reminding me. Yes, so cookbooks are some of our most popular titles. And this year we have a special cookbook that we are reissuing, which was first published in 1987 by Chef Henry Holler. It's on pre-sale now if it interests you. But he worked for five presidents, Johnson through Reagan. And his cookbook is a very kind of personal family style cookbook. So it's not the food that was made for state dinners, but it's the food that the first families enjoyed. So there is the Nixon family meatloaf and Mrs. Ford's favorite Reuben sandwich and macaroni and cheese that President Reagan loved, that Chef Holler actually made for President Reagan after the attempted assassination while he was at the hospital. Chef Holler made that for him to eat in the hospital. And the nice thing about Chef Holler's book is that he tells the story behind each recipe. So there's a lot of White House history mixed in with mixed in with a lot of really doable, doable recipes. So it's a fun cookbook.
Is Trisha Nixon's wedding cake recipe in that book?
It sure is. There's three. I think there's three wedding cakes.
Wow.
In this cookbook, the two Johnson brides' wedding cakes are in there, and Trisha Nixon's wedding cake. And there's also a bridal shower recipe, which is called Flower Pot Sunday, which I think was first made by Lady Bird Johnson, but it's served in a little terracotta pot. And then it has, you know, cake and meringue and a flower on top, which is connected to her, you know, beautification program. So she served the flower pot sundaes a lot, but they were also served at a bridal reception.
Well, I predict that book is gonna be a great success.
Thanks, Colleen, I hope so.
Mm-hmm. So the last question I have to ask you, Marcia, because you've been in and out of the White House for many years, and you've worked on many editions of the guidebook and all these other lovely books that you've talked about. And I have to ask you, if you had to choose, what is your favorite room in the White House and why?
Well, it's kind of a hard question. I think it has changed over the years. So when I started my job, I was really in awe of the staterooms. I mean, they're just so beautiful and majestic, and to see those rooms in person, you know, three-dimensional is, you know, a real thrill and an honor to experience. And now I think I especially like some of the lesser seen rooms, like the kitchen. I think the kitchen's fascinating. It's a very small kitchen. When you think about all of the food that's produced there, that's amazing too. So I think I've changed a little bit over time. And then I think one of the things that happens to me is like rooms that I've had good memories in from, you know, working with so many wonderful people. And as I walk through, I kind of remember those people and think about the work that we've done together. And, you know, that could be something as simple as like the ground floor corridor, where I remember, say, a curator explaining a portrait to me. And that kind of thing just sticks with you, I think, for the rest of your life. So I still sort of experience those memories when I walk through spaces.
Well, thank you so much, Marcia, for joining us this evening on White House History Live. And for all of our viewers, don't forget to go to our website, whitehousehistory.org, and order your new 60th edition White House guidebook today. Please join us next month, September 6th, when my colleague, Matt Costello, is joined by senior historians from the National Portrait Gallery and the Library of Congress to talk about their recent exhibits on Watergate. Thank you very much for watching, and we'll see you next month.
Thanks, Colleen. Thanks, everybody.